Conflict of interest. It's a hot topic that frequently appears in many professional discussions about ethics and HR guidelines of codes of conduct, especially in our day and age today when we see so many cases of corruption and professional misconduct in the corporate world as well as amongst government officials and world leaders today in the 21st century. But did you know that Islam had already addressed the issue of conflict of interest and had outlined clear-cut guidelines in the Qur'an and Sunnah over 1,400 years ago on how to handle this issue of conflict of interest? So in this episode, inshallah, we're speaking about what is conflict of interest, how can conflict of interest come about, especially in ways which we sometimes take for granted or we don't even realize, and what are some objective guidelines on how best we can handle the issues of conflict of interest from the perspective of Islam. Brothers and sisters, just wanted to share with all of you, in hindsight, this is actually one of the very first episodes that we recorded as a team in the podcast. In fact, back then in October 2020, we did not even have a name for the podcast yet. The name, the Barakah Effect Podcast, didn't even exist for us back then. So watching the recording of this episode brings back many fond memories of our humble beginnings. Back then, we barely had any equipment. We had no idea how our conversation chemistry was going to be like. We had no idea how long our episodes are going to be. And our delivery style and methods seems very much unrefined and even very amateur, if I'm being honest. And you can hear many, many Malaysian slang words being used throughout the entire conversation, especially from me, subhanAllah. Sometimes I feel that this conversation is just so Malaysian that you could even taste the durian, subhanAllah. So please bear with us with this very Manglish style of delivery, this very Malay plus English style of delivery throughout this episode, inshallah. Also, for your information, brothers and sisters, back then we had Brother Firdaus in the team, but قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ وَمَشَاءَ فَعَلْ, because of his other ongoing commitments, he had to pull out very early on from the team, and we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to reward all of his efforts and contributions to the podcast, and may Allah Azza wa Jal grant him and his family success for all of their endeavors. Ameen. In the meantime, if you are new here, brothers and sisters, ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. Welcome to the Barakah Effect Podcast, the weekly podcast where we dissect pearls of wisdoms from the Quran and Sunnah to turn them into our unfair advantage to gain success here and hereafter. Please do subscribe to our channel over at YouTube and the other podcast platforms. Hope you guys find value in this one. This is episode 12, Conflict of Interest, an Islamic Perspective.
ولو أن أهل القرى آمنوا واتقوا لفتحنا عليهم بركات من السماء والأرض.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. So alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, ahlan bikum. Alhamdulillah, all praise and thanks to Allah Azza wa Jal. So for this episode, inshallah, we'll be discussing on the topic of conflict of interest from the eyes of a Muslim. So first of all, let's start off by discussing this topic. What is conflict of interest and why is it so important? So since Brother Amir brought this subject up, so you may have the privilege of starting off this session and just enlightening us on what this topic is about.
MashaAllah, MashaAllah, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Bismillah. First of all, it's always a pleasure to be among the company of brothers, especially for tonight. I think the topic itself is very interesting. And I think it will garner a lot of point of discussion among the participants, inshallah. So as what I gather from Transparency International, it's a global anti-corruption and anti-bribery organization. Yeah, so to try to give a bit of a definition of what conflict of interest, or in short, I can say COI. So it's when an individual working for an entity is confronted with choosing between the duties and demands of their position and their own private interest. Yeah, so it's in short. Yeah, COI is when a person needs to make decision and he has a lot of interest he needs to consider. So there's a fear that he might be impartial, there's a fear he might be biased, yeah, and have some favoritism in his decision, which might be an advantage to himself, but to a disadvantage to its organization. Yeah. So they brought a lot of as a starter, they say that COI itself is not a crime. In fact, COI, it's almost difficult or impossible to avoid. Because human beings, we have multiple relationships, yeah?
So
each relationship, we have two-way interests, yeah? So you will always have to combine all these interests, yeah? So having that COI itself, it's not a crime, but how you manage that, yeah? So that how you manage that, and if you manage it poorly, so that might lead to doors of corruption and crime and so on, yeah? And then also conflict of interest as what I was exposed in my company in the training pack, yeah? So they talk about like what is actual interest and what is perceived interest. So actual interest interests which are related directly to your role, yeah? Whereby perceived interests are something not so tangible. So it's you might not be making a decision based on that perceived interest, but sometimes you just need to take a step back. Say, if the sequence of event line up, will people bring an idea? Say, oh, he's doing that because he's this and that.
Right.
So that's perceived interest. It's not tangible. Yeah.
Okay. So how, what does that? Yeah. What does that mean in practice? Like, what is an example of perceived interest versus what was that? What was the first one, Didi?
Actual interest, yeah.
Actual interest, yeah. So how does that look like in practice?
So in actual interest, like for instance, yeah, if you run, if you have a share, or you have, or you actually runs a secondary company that supplies a product which your company needs. So that's actual interest, yeah.
Okay.
You actually, meaning if I work at a, for example, electrical power company, and I have a second company which selling cables.
That's right. You're a shareholder. You're a shareholder for a company that supplies electrical goods. Yeah. So that's actually.
So that is actual interest.
That's right. That's right.
I guess it's something with clarity that is in conflict of interest of to what your role is. Something that's clear.
Something very direct.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Okay, so something that's genuinely tangible, you definitely have a vested personal interest okay. So that covers actual interest.
Yeah. And perceived interest is something, sometimes it involves relationships. So for instance, yeah. So I am say my wife works in the, as a procurement officer in the supplier. Yeah, but she doesn't get involved with the dealings related to my work. But some people might say, he's buying from her, from that same company that my wife works, is because they are related. But it's not the case at times. Eh? So that's perceived. It has to do with relationship. Yeah. And how does my organization, when they teach conflict of interest, yeah, they tend to say like components of it. Yeah, like when you say conflict of interest, so usually comes from a personal relationship, yeah. It comes from a financial interest from external entity. It involves perhaps like a gift and hospitality. So this is a big chunk to conflict of interest. It also includes favors, includes a lobby, all things like that. Yeah? And also outside employment or secondary, they call it a secondary role that you have. For instance, you have you're a shareholder for another company. Or maybe you sit in a board of advisory for an NGO, for instance. Yeah, sometimes it can be you are also an NGO for a charity foundation. But sometimes what happens is maybe your company donates to that charity foundation every year. So that's perceived interest. Right. Yeah, there's something.
Right.
But maybe because they genuinely need that money, and somebody else resides on that. So yeah, that's also an example. Yeah. So these are the four components, four doors that can come to COI. As when we say the scope of COI in the workplace. Yeah.
That's interesting.
Okay. Maybe before we go to the what is the problem? Yeah. And I just like to say like why suddenly COI has become like gained so much traction in the media. Yeah. So recently, I think in the past since 1990s. Yeah. So I think one of the reasons is right now you see a lot of all those like international monetary scandals. All of that has to do with an originated from some sort of a mishandling of COI. So I think like a famous one, like if I can just give some examples, like, you know, the FIFA 2010 scandal, yeah, whereby the president appointed an advisor, paid them a good amount of money, but doesn't have any contract, any official contract. But that advisor, one of the function is to control the association members, and association members are the one that elects the president. So he has some conflict of interest somewhere.
Okay, right.
So it's still under, I think it's still under investigation. I'm not too sure about what's the current status of that. Another one is, I think it's about some big oil major companies. Yeah. So I think a few of them, they were slapped with big hefty fines because by the EU Commission. So what happened was they kind of gang up and they fixed the price of certain products like bitumen behind against the lawmakers. Yeah. So later was found out, and all of them and got hefty fines for that. Yeah, and these are not and these are organizations which spend a lot of money to train their people on ethics. So they themselves fall into this problem. Yeah, and they are companies. Sometimes they have like annual questionnaires, exams, just to get people up to speed in terms of awareness of all these kind of unethical dealings. And they themselves fall into the short of this. And finally, maybe something closer to home. Yeah? This is quite big. A local airline carrier, a private one. Yeah. So I think they're caught in this shady deals with one of the biggest European airline airplane maker. So something to do when they purchase when this airplane manufacturer sell some of these some of their flights to this airline carrier. So they also gave a big chunk of donation to the sports entity, which is related to this airline carrier owners. So this is an ongoing case, an ongoing trial. It's also getting attention in the UK as well as back in Malaysia. So with all these three cases, yeah, the consequence can be quite impactful. It can go from hefty fines, loss of reputation, plunge in your stock market, your inability to do future business, to get contracts in the future, and also it can lead to imprisonment of personnel, yeah, people. So companies try their best nowadays to create an awareness among the employees about the impact of like conflict of interest, and how can it, if you manage it wrongly, poorly, the sort of consequence that the whole organization and themselves will face. So that's why it became like a lot of focus nowadays. Yeah.
I see.
Right. The thing about conflict of interest, right? Sometimes it's not as apparent as it can be. You know, sometimes it's a bit of a subjective thing. So, as a company, sometimes how do you set the policy in that sense? Do you do a blanket ban on any perceived interest dealings, or is there room or flexibility in that sense to deal? Like a certain flexibility to deal with, let's say, relationships between clients and contractors, for example. Because I think when it's categorized into the actual interest, it's quite clear that there's a certain set of regulations and you are in conflict with that rule or law. When it comes to perceived, it might not be so clear. You know, it has the question whether whether is it really the case or it can be otherwise as well. So as an organization to protect yourself, like how do they deal with this circumstances? I can add to from my personal experience in that sense, organization that I've worked with, let's say they're quite strict in the dealings in, let's say, conflict of interest. So the employee, when they are on board with the company, there's a set of rules outlined in the employee handbook, which says that there is no, let's say, tolerance at all, even if you want to treat a potential client to a meal, for example. So that's quite a tough stance on the topic of perceived conflict of interest. And in that sense, perhaps we can view it as a way of blocking the means, in the sense that you will have a high probability or chance that your organization won't end up in trouble due to the company's, due to the employees' dealings. But at the same time, does it restrict the business moving forward? So that's quite a big question to answer, I believe. But so far as I can see, what has been practiced, in a sense, for the employees, gives you a peace of mind in the sense that there's clear rules that deals with it, and you should not go over the rules. So as an employee in one of that organizations, I find that gives me a bit of peace of mind, so that when someone, let's say, in a theoretical scenario, would invite me for dinner just to treat me for dinner because there's a perceived interest, for example, I would just say that, oh, my company doesn't allow that. It's clearly written as a policy, so I'm not able to exceed that boundary.
Does our Sharia, the Quran or Hadith, specifically put boundaries into this stuff? Is there anything within our trade laws, our mu'amalat, that specifies things that avoid these kinds of conflicts?
So can I share one fatwa by Lajna Daima on
sure,
that?
Sure, yeah. Right. Yeah.
So there was a mashallah, I think this was the question was this, yeah? One question to say, I'm a doctor working in a government hospital. Can I accept meal from my pharmaceutical vendor? Mm. So Lajna Daima said no, you right. cannot.
Oh.
He even said you can't even if you run your own private clinic.
Oh, mashallah.
Yeah, because the other day, mashallah, sorry to interject, but I just remembered this something that my sheikh told me last week during our class. So he said this situation right here, the one that Amir and Reza is referring to right now, is something called al-istikthar. Al-istikthar is to and it falls under one of the categories of riba.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, because why? The sense because it has the potential. For example, I am buying my client lunch, for example, today. With this, I am hoping that I will get something bigger from him, you know, in the future. So probably because one day when probably there's a project coming up, and probably with that favor that I have given him in the form of that meal, that lunch, you know, he probably will think of me, and he, oh, yeah. Khalas,
he'll notify you
project,
first.
I will give it to you. So yeah. Al-istikthar meaning is to, you know, to give something small in return, in hopes that you will get a bigger return. So this, it's interesting that my sheikh, he told me that this falls under one of the categories of riba. So, Smanul, it's like I think that is what the mashayikh has, you know, the basis on why they would ban this practice.
To get
can I share a hadith? Also, I think this hadith is about specifically about gift and hospitality. Yeah, like because I will just share it in meaning. I would not read the matan in translation. So it's about. During the time of Prophet Muhammad SAW, so he appointed a zakat collector.
No.
So, but that so the zakat collector name is Ibn Al Ludbiyah. Yeah. So this hadith is narrated from a companion named Abu Humayd As Sa'idi. Yeah. So in meaning, so the zakat collector. So what he does is that he collect the money from the people and he asks for some gift. So later when that money he gave to the Prophet, he said, okay, this is for you and this is for me, give. And the Prophet admonished him for that. So from just that hadith, come out so many rulings. The rulings can be as simple as just now, like buying lunch accepting lunch from a vendor to he went all the way to a fixed discussion like if an employee who also happens to be a business partner and who gets percentage of shares, So does that is the income from percentage of share, is that share, is that halal? Because now he's being paid as an employee, and he also receive incentive in terms of profit. So is that halal or haram? So they also talk about this. So meaning that the discussion became quite complicated. Yeah.
Right.
But one of the Sheikh Al-Munajjid uses this hadith to refer when he explains some of the fatwa with regards to gift and hospitality.
Yeah. I'm quite familiar with the hadith. Yeah. It's from Sahih Bukhari 7174. I think the key point in this hadith is I would say the meaning only, yeah. Why didn't he stay at his father's or mother's house to see whether he will be given gift or not? Is this a hadith, I mean?
Yes, sahih. Same one, yeah.
MashaAllah. That's the, I think, clear cut ruling that if we stay at home, do we get the gift? Do we get the meals?
Can you repeat that again? So how does that relate to staying at home? How is that related to that gift situation?
It's like, it's a continue of Amir's hadith just now.
Okay.
And this is until one point. Okay, after Rasulullah
Rasulullah
glorify and praise Allah, he said, what is wrong with the employee whom we send to collect the zakat from the public, that he returns to say, this is for you and this is for me? And he continues, why didn't he stay at his father's or mother's house to see whether he will be given gift or not? Meaning,
questioning, yeah.
So basically,
very good.
Right.
Does anyone wants to give him a gift?
Money?
Right.
Yeah. So are you getting the gift because by virtue of you collecting the zakah?
Yeah.
Or is it because people are genuinely giving you a gift?
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
at the same time, because the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, at the same time, we are encouraged to give gifts. It's no doubt, as Muslims, that's something that should increase love between you. Tapi are you doing that with the intention because you want to pay the zakah guy? Or because you genuinely want to buy a gift for that person? And I think like what Shami highlighted today, it's actually something directly I recall from Surah Al-Mudathir. Allah says, "Wala tamnun tastakthir." Don't give with the intention of or expecting something in return.
MashaAllah. Sorry, can you repeat the ayat again, Brother Faizal?
It's Surah Al-Mudathir. "Wala tamnun tastakthir." Yeah, so actually, one of the things that really garnered my interest here when it comes to conflict of interest, especially when it comes to perceived conflict of interest, it always comes back to the issue of integrity and professionalism. So your perceived conflict of interest, are you in a position where you are compromising your objectivity in dealing with the right way? So it all comes back to integrity. And as a Muslim, this is something that we really is very powerful that we have, because we have this belief in Allah and the last day. So one of the verses that should drive integrity is the fact that all of us will be accountable for every single deed that we do in the sight of Allah. So Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمَن تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Remember and fear the day that you will return to Allah. ثُمَّ تُوَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَّا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. And every single soul will be recompensed for every single thing that he did, and he will not be oppressed. So the thing is, when it comes to how we deal with our actions in this dunya, this is regardless of whether you get caught or not, or whether you actually, expose or not. Yeah. Because at the end of the day, Allah will expose that deed. So you have to ask yourself, any situation that you're in, are you in a compromising situation? Are you in a situation where if you were to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you say that, Allah, I did this and I didn't mean anything, can you genuinely say that or not? Because on the day of judgment, there's no more lying. On today, in courts, you can come up with excuse, you can come up with evidence, you can come up with witnesses to support you, testimonials. But in the court of Allah, that's impossible already. So that's a very important point, accountability. And one of the things that, because when we talk about conflict of interest, one of the things that really brings up a lot is the topic of nepotism and cronyism. So I think as Amir pointed out today, if you have a wife who's working in a company and so on and so forth, so you may have a perceived vested interest. Now, there's a very interesting hadith by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as narrated by Sahih al-Bukhari. So in this particular situation, a Jewish woman was caught stealing. So this Jewish woman was somebody who was a pretty high, you can say a noble lady. So these people wanted to intercede. So what they did is they appealed to Usama bin Zaid bin Haritha. So Usama had a very special place in the household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Usama was the son of Zaid. And Zaid, before adoption was something that was prohibited in Islam, Zaid was practically the son of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the adopted son. So Usama was sort of like a grandson. So everyone, the companions knew that Usama had the special place in the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when this Jewish woman was caught stealing, so they said, yeah, Usama, he's going to listen to you. So why don't you go and sweet talk him, so that this woman will not have to be punished because of her theft. So when Usama went to see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says he got angry and says the people before you were destroyed because when a noble person was caught stealing, they will let him go. And when a poor person or somebody of just a normal average guy was stolen, then they would cut off his hand. But let me tell you something. So I'm paraphrasing the hadith. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, wallahi, if Fatima bint Muhammad, if my own daughter was caught stealing, I would definitely cut off her hand. So this was a very important lesson for us. This shows us that, sure, you may have what is called a perceived conflict of interest, but at the end of the day, this should not decrease in your objectivity in how you deal with that person. Because just because you have family ties with that person, it should not affect in how, it should not cloud your judgment. Because it can work for, in favor, and also negatively as well. Because sometimes when you are very, you know, personally involved in people's lives, you also know their not so positive side. You know what I mean? So family ties are not always in your favor. Huh? So sometimes, you know, you have a cousin or your brother or an uncle in the organization, they're like, oh, this guy is pretty good. Huh? And you guys see him here. I know what he does at home.
Like. 9 to 5, see him.
So at the end of the day, it always comes down to objectivity and integrity. Like, and it comes to like your intention as well. So that perceived conflict of interest. So for example, let's bring a very simple example, like the example that Ami brought today. So if you were to hire somebody who is your family member, so let's say that you hire your own daughter into your organization, for example, like, are you doing that? You have to be able to ask yourself honestly, especially in the sight of Allah on the day of judgment, did you genuinely hire your daughter because you really, truly, objectively, professionally felt that she was the right person for the job? Or is it just because it's your daughter? This is something yang it gets very challenging. So, and of course, it's not the same for everyone. So when you want to practice this, there's another hadith, which to me is a very important principle. So this is hadith, it's hadith number 27 in the 40 hadith of Imam An-Nawawi. So the meaning of the hadith is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ask yourself. So you need to ask yourself whether that thing is something that gives you comfort in your heart or not. So something which is good, then that gives you sort of that peace of mind. Tapi if you yourself feel that something is like, ah, man, I don't feel right about this, it makes you feel unrest, then this is something that you should stay away from. Even if they give a fatwa that it's halal.
Yeah.
Because this bias doesn't just exist between family members. For example, if I know you by an activity that we do together, maybe we meet at the masjid, maybe we meet at the halaqah, I'm going to like you a bit more.
Yeah. Who's
going to know that?
That's right.
Yes, correct.
Okay, can I add something to your point just now about employing your daughter, yeah?
Yeah, so very good.
That's an after by Umar. So Umar said this, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Umar said, it's actually from Abdul Malik ibn Umar, reported Umar al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, said, whoever employs a man among his loved ones or relative, employ him for no other reasons besides that, and because of only the blood ties, then he has betrayed Allah, his messenger, and the believers. Musnad al-Faruq, 740.
Wow.
So, Allah.
Favoritism right there. I mean, how to, the danger of favoritism. Yeah? So Umar al-Khattab.
This is, yeah.
Yeah, you know what's interesting, that one of the things that really struck me in terms of the sirah of the companions radiallahu anhum was the story of Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan. So Muawiyah was the Amirul Mu'minin of the Muslims. Just a trivia fact, he was Khalifa number what?
Number six.
Yes, that's right. Number six. Not bad. You've been doing your homework.
Alhamdulillah.
All right. So let's digress a bit. Who was number five?
Hassan.
Mashallah, mashallah. Very good, very good. Barakallahu fikum. Yeah, so Muawiyah was in a very interesting position because he was the first king in Islam. So he was Amirul Mu'minin. But what he did is he appointed his son, Yazid, to become Khalifa. Yeah. Now, when I learned the sirah of what actually happened is, the reason why Muawiyah, radiallahu anhuma, he chose his son to be the Khalifa after him was because he felt that the one who had the rightful position to be Khalifa was somebody who could control the army of Sham. So the Muslim nation at the time was at a place where they were in rapid expansion. So the ijtihad that the Khalifa did, the Amirul Mu'minin did at the time, was that he felt that the one who can control the army is the one who's most fit to do it. And my son, Yazid, is the one who has the ability to do it, to control the army. So he chose Yazid because he felt that that was the best person for the job at the time. So he can answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that that is his judgment. Now, people may look at that deed and say that, he just chose his son because of this. But then again, at the end of the day, it comes between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So at the end of the day, something which is perceived as a conflict of interest, if you know full well that you've done it for the objective reason, for the intention of the greater good for the organization, and in this case, the Muslim Ummah. Now bear in mind, Muawiyah was a companion, radiallahu anhu, who was promised paradise himself. So if you do that with the intention to seek the pleasure of Allah, then alhamdulillah, then you have that peace of mind. So because I thought of another situation as well. I don't know if you have thought about this. I thought about the other extreme. Let's say you're in a situation where you have two candidates for a job. So candidate A is your son. Your son is qualified. He's great. He's got experience. He's got a good attitude. And you have candidate B who is not really qualified. He doesn't have the right experience and he doesn't have a great attitude. But in your pressure, you purposely hire candidate B because you don't want to be perceived as conflict of interest. That makes sense?
Right.
If you do that just because you want to avoid that, then you have actually committed an oppression because you're not doing what's in the right interest of the organization.
Because thing like the pillars of conflict interest, yeah, it's all based to ihsan, yeah, how relationship with other human beings, yeah. So if you know what sort of rights you need to give and what sort of rights you need to take, and you do it in the best way, so then. You will almost at all times avoid conflict of interest because you give the rights of his rights and you just take whatever is yours. You're not going to give less or you're going to take more. Yeah. Right. But of course, those things have to be built upon knowledge. Yeah? You wouldn't know whose right is correct unless you have knowledge, and you wouldn't know what is black, white or grey unless also you have knowledge. Yeah?
Mashallah, good point.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay, so I noticed there's a lot of discussion about giving gifts and so on. So let's address the elephant in the room. So when it comes to this relationship between contractor and client, right? So can there be a middle ground where you actually genuinely have a good relationship, personal relationship between client and contractor?
I read so far, you can have that, yeah. From the Islamic aid, some of the questions say you can. But try, as in, don't take gifts. Do not take gifts.
Don't take gifts. Fantastic.
Yeah. Not taking gifts. Yeah, the question actually went further to, for instance, yeah, teachers and students. Yeah. So if you're, can you give to a teacher in common? Then the answer was, Sheikh Hamunaji said, yes, you can. Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah said, yes. However, if the teacher teaches in a public school, then you cannot. Because that might give favoritism. Even after the question goes like this, can I receive gift from the parents of my students after I've marked all their exam papers and given all their certifications?
Okay, wow.
Then no. This is after exam, finished, nothing. Is between is there between the teacher and the student? Say no, you cannot.
Wow, even though because
it's a public officer, so it also involves lecturers and things like that, yeah.
Right.
But if it's on a private teacher, then no issue. As what I read, but if it's a government or post, no, you can't. Stay away from that.
Right. Very good. Very good.
About gifts, just now, yeah, Akhi Faisal, yeah. So certain organization, yeah, they allow gift, but they cap it. The two things they have to happen. Right. You have to cap the gift, and then you have to declare that gift.
Yeah.
No matter how, no matter it's just a t-shirt or a cap, you just gotta declare that. Just to, so everyone's on the clear of that. Yeah. So there's one barrier they can introduce.
Yeah,
Interesting that you mentioned. It's interesting that you mentioned the filter that put yourself outside of your role, whether you will be treated the same or not. Because honestly, I've experienced it a few times in my role throughout the years. Sometimes you are just caught in the middle. For example, you are part of the team, and there is a client as a client, and there's a of course there's a contractor working under you. So then the contractor says, "Okay, I'll treat all of you to a good seafood restaurant today. Let's go, everyone." Right?
Okay.
So how do you deal with that situation? Because if you take yourself away and say that, "Okay, I don't agree with this," you might alienate yourself from your working colleagues, and you might be even like, let's say they would say like, "Why are you so self-righteous?" You know. But I think it's important to have that principle as a Muslim, because in the end, you're not, you might have that good meal or good time in that short space of time, in the space of like that day. Eventually, when you keep in mind that you will meet Allah and present all your deeds in front of Allah one day, there is no running away from whatever, let's say, inconsistency that you have done. If you keep that in mind, I think that is a way of, let's say, giving you a peace of mind, even in the face that you might be going against the grain, for example, or you might be alienated if you do the right thing. So, sometimes it's not straightforward.
How do you run from the situation?
I just said I'm not having lunch today.
Oh, mashallah.
Okay.
Authenticity.
That's a very good point. Because you know, in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, the halal is clear and the haram is clear. But in between, there are things which are gray area, and the majority of mankind, they don't know what to do. So whoever indulges in these gray areas, then eventually you will reach a point where you might potentially trap into the borders of haram, and eventually you fall into that area. So if you just stay away from it, then you save yourself. You save your honor and you save your deen. So one of the things that we have to understand is that we have to always practice this degree of self-awareness. So not everybody has the same discipline to control their emotion and their biases. We have to all acknowledge that. Some people, like, they can be tough on their own daughters, right? It's just, they have that kind of strength, right? But some people, with friend masjid also, gikichan lah, kan? One of the things that really stuck out to me, kan, macam, was a story in Sirah, where Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu anhu, one of the things that he was criticized for in the people of Fitnah that tried to accuse him of, one of the things, is that they said that he always spent for his family. He always spent money to give to his family. So in his defense, he said that, well, before I became Khalifa, I was already a wealthy person. So this was from my own personal wealth. This has nothing to do with the treasury. So I give them because this is the way I want to spend for the sake of Allah. So then the people accused him and they say that, well, Umar wasn't like that. The Khalifa before you, Amirul Mu'minin before you, he was very strict on his family members. When his family members ate something luxurious, he would be strict on them, he would scold them, he would give them a hard time. And here you are, you're spoiling your family members. Now, this was the best part of it. So Uthman ibn Affan said what? He says, Umar did that seeking the pleasure of Allah, and I did what I did seeking the pleasure of Allah.
MashaAllah.
That was brilliant, man. Like, that situation called for that. And he can answer for his deed in the sight of Allah, and I can answer for my deed in the sight of Allah. So this is
having said that, I remembered the saying of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, who said something like, he said, rahimahullah, al-hikmatu fi'lu alladhi yanbaghi fi waqti alladhi yanbaghi, meaning to say, al-hikmah, this is wisdom. What you see is wisdom, is the action that is needed during the time that is needed and at the right moment that is needed. So during the time of Omar, this is what was needed. This situation pertains to that.
Mashallah.
And as for Osman, this is what was needed and this is what was made easy for him to do. So this is what he did. But but despite all of that, both of them goes to the same usul, which is to please Allah Azza wa Jal.
Mashallah.
This should be one of the things that we always have to bear in mind, mashallah.
Mashallah, brilliant. Actually, one of the interesting things was conflict of interest that I came across. I don't know if you thought about this as well. Have you thought about the position of being hired as an auditor or not? Have you ever thought about that role?
Yeah,
think about it this way.
You're being paid by a company to say bad about them, so, or to really go into their accounts and really pick up things which might be exposing them, but you're paid
exactly.
By them.
Hire you. So for example, I'm a company and I hire you. Let's say you're an audit firm, but I hire you for purposes of getting certified. But your role is to look for mistakes, is to look for loopholes. And you see, as a company, I'm going to go like, if you're going to find so much faults in me, I think I'm going to go find someone else after this. So you as an audit company have this dilemma now. Am I really going to do my job and really find faults with them and really be very, very detailed and very, very precise in looking for these mistakes? If I do so, I might lose my clientele.
it's very interesting.
There's no way around it, you know. That's what it is. You just have to settle it for what it is. So I realized that for people to hire people to be in audit firms, they need to be like people who have superb integrity, like airtight, right. You know.
Right.
But that wouldn't be the problem for Jakim, for example. You know, they go around and audit premises and restaurants, hotels and whatnot. They have no choice but to, just to please the people who come and audit their places, right?
Mm.
But the one is paid. Right. They're not paid by the end user, by the auditor. They are paid by the end user themselves.
Okay.
But I think what's saving grace for that is I think that those auditors are actually bounded by law, so they have a law to that the law will back them up. Right, eventually, yeah.
Yes, exactly.
And I think those auditors, right, they would have a certain level of standard. Let's say there's a certain minimum standard that they have to adhere to remain relevant in their industry. So anything that comes up which is not correct, then it is a bad rep for them, basically. So I think that's how it works, but I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah, to hold them accountable.
Right.
Yeah, actually, one of the interesting thing is, this is precisely the same line of reasoning why many scholars of our righteous predecessors, they refuse to take government positions. Because if they are paid by the government, they might be compelled to give fatwa in favor of the government. So Imam Ahmad was a very famous example of this. He was somebody who refused to receive anything, even if he was served food, which he knows that person bought, his own son, bought from the money that was given from the government, he refused to eat it. He didn't say it's haram, but he wanted to stay clear from any form of shubha whatsoever. Because there were scholars before him, like Imam Malik, he was forced to give fatwa in favor of the Khalifa. So the Khalifa wanted to issue a verdict and say that if you resign from the government, you automatically divorce to your wife. So Imam Ahmad said, I can't do it. This is ridiculous. I can't rule in something of favor.
Imam Malik
bin Anas. Yeah, but because of that, he got imprisoned. And that's why he got beaten up. That's why he couldn't lift his arms.
Yeah.
So when you are paid by the government, you have this this subconscious feeling of appealing to the ones who pay your who sign your paycheck. Put it that way. So this is
That's a good point, Akhi Faisal, about this, and Akhi Rizal just now. Because I think sometimes, what we tend to do is like we limit conflict of interest only to workplace. It can be more than that, right? It can be family, and different circumstances. It brings to different consequences. For instance, conflict of interest among a ruler and a subject becomes treason. Consequence, conflict of interest between family members becomes poor parenting. or in research, conflict of interest in research becomes cheating. All right. I mean, but all call a conflict of interest because they need to manage different interests. Yeah? Even sometimes on a personal level, maybe it will not result to being impartial or biased. Like whether abusing or misusing your company facilities, yeah, or an interest of, let's say, I just want to print up some da'wah books, right? Using the company's printer. After working time. So Ibn Taymiyyah said, this is haram, you cannot do that. Even though you need to do it for da'wah, after working time, in your spare time, it's still haram. Because you're mixing up your interests as a student and as an employee. Yeah.
Some people replace the A4 paper, but how about the ink, right?
That's right.
That's right.
You have to buy the ink lah.
Super. Actually, one of the another situation that I've perceived before when it comes to conflict of interest, I don't know if you observe this, but sometimes when you have high performing staff, there are some people who have reluctance to promote them or transfer them out because they want it's for their own convenience. So for example, if you have that good performing staff, promoting them would either mean you have to start competing with them or you have to start losing them away from your department.
That's a genuine
dilemma, because if I'm going to promote this guy, I'm going to lose one manpower and I'm going to go through the hassle of looking for somebody else.
Yeah.
So
and a good one actually, at that.
Yeah, and somebody who's good at that.
Losing talent right there.
Yeah, you lose talent right there. Like a very simple example, this is something that happens many times that I've heard of. Like people who are refused to be transferred out because the boss just simply doesn't want to find a replacement. It's just too much hassle for them. Even though transferring out means that you can, it's maybe for a personal reason, maybe you need to be with your family member who's sick, or maybe for professional reason, maybe you need to transfer out to gain more exposure, to develop in your career. And this is actually for the betterment of the company. So in the long run, this is something that's better. But in the short term, it's going to make your life difficult.
So he's favoring his interest instead of the company's interest, yeah?
Right. This is very dangerous, you know, because he can always use the excuse that this is for business needs. I need you here. This is for business needs. And this is very dangerous. But this time you have to ask yourself honestly, like if you were to answer to Allah, is this really because for business need or is it because you just can't be bothered to look for the right replacement? So here's the thing, right? Because when people do this too much in an organization, this is when people start to say things like, there's no point in being a high performing staff. Because if you do your job too well, they'll refuse to let you go. They refuse to promote you because they need you for that job. And if you start speaking like that, you see the point? If you start speaking like that, what kind of organization is it going to be?
You doom
yourself
to
this.
So what the guy have to do, Akhi Faisal? I mean, the poor guy or maybe one of us?
That's a very good question. So again, of course, when we make decisions, it's never in isolation. So you have to look at genuinely, is there a business need? Can you find somebody else? Is this in the interest of the staff as a whole? Can you find a solution that can actually allow, like, do you care for that person's development in a way that you can support that person? While at the same time, you also find a backup plan for yourself. It's a bit more work. But here's the thing. As a leader, you have to be willing to work extra for your subordinates. So that's just the way things are. Tapi if you're going to purposely avoid that for avoiding work, answer Allah in the day of judgment.
That's right.
Right. Inshallah.
Yeah, and also another thing as well. This crossed my mind as well. You see, activity partners tend to have inherent biases in the workplace. So what I mean by activity partners? So simple things like maybe you meet somebody in the masjid. So you have this perception that, oh, he's a practicing Muslim, mashallah. So I kind of like this guy a bit more than the guy who is maybe not so practicing. I've never seen him at the surau.
Yeah.
And here's a very, 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 very common example. Golfing partners. Have you heard that phrase? Like,
yes.
You should learn. What's that?
Golf buddies, yeah.
Golf buddies, right? Akhi, you should start playing golf, man. All the bosses play golf. If you play golf, you get an audience with them.
Right now, the famous one is cyclist.
Like
this. Oh, no way.
There's a trend now.
There's a trend today.
Right, right.
Most bosses are cycling right now.
So again, okay, this is also a fine line because again, I really like what Amir said there. Conflict of interest by in and of itself is not a problem. It's what you do with it. So again, like if you genuinely like the sport, if you genuinely like playing golf, if you genuinely like cycling, then khalas, go ahead. But you have to ask yourself, if your boss wasn't cycling, would you go cycle or not? So if the boss wasn't playing golf, would you play golf or not? How are you really doing that just because you want to be in or not? And also actually, this is actually very similar to this thing about social smoking. And you know, I say this because I myself, when I first started working, I haven't quit smoking yet. And I noticed that people who are smoking with the bosses who smoke, they always have this special audience. And you see, this is a problem, you know, because this actually highlights something even deeper. It highlights the fact that the bosses don't spend time with their subordinates enough. So the only way for you to get a proper audience with them is you have to do something haram. Oh, this is a problem.
Right.
So it even comes to a point where some people say that, actually, I was considering to quit. But if I do that, then so it's difficult to get screen time with the boss. So, wow, subhanAllah, this is very problematic.
That point. I think Akhi Shami shared something interesting about this, about shirik, small shirik, whereby you do an act of haram to please other people.
Subhanallah.
And it can lead to some small shirik on that. Maybe it's a different topic, but it can lead to that consequence.
Subhanallah.
So this is actually a very fine line. I mean, alhamdulillah, one of the things that I'm very grateful for is that we work in Malaysia. So the culture of drinking is maybe not so prevalent. But in Western worlds, like this whole thing is a very common thing. And so if you work in the Western world, like if you were not to join them at the pubs, you would lose out on a lot of these kind of things. So for you to have that dilemma is actually quite psychologically like oppressive. Because for you to not join the crowd suddenly gives you at a situation of a disadvantage. But what I learned from this is we have to be careful because we do have relationships outside. So it's fine. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. In fact, you should have good relationships with people outside as Muslims, as fellow brothers in Islam. But at the end of the day, you should not allow for these relationships to cloud your judgment and your objectivity in your decision-making in the office, in the working environment.
Talking about relationship, because sometimes people tend to use relationship for favors. There's a quote by Ibn Taymiyyah. Say something like this, like you're equal to another person as long as you never ask anything from him. And you are actually above that person when you help him out. So actually if you completely free yourself from any needs from him, actually you're equal, even though if he's a king or someone, your bosses. But I don't need you to come and I know my work and I deliver it and I'm very confident of what I do. I don't need your approval. If you give it, alhamdulillah. If you don't give it, I'm free of that. I don't need that. Free of you. So I get it from one of the quotes Dr. Firanda shared about Ibn Taymiyyah when he talks about this productive Muslim.
Okay, mashallah, very good. Yeah, that's a very good point. Actually, there's one more very interesting point. When we talk about biases, let's talk about something a bit more general. It's not just biases. So what companies tend to do, I think Reza highlighted this very early on. So they try to block the means. So for example, if you have a family member who works in a contractor company, by the company policy, you are told to declare it to the human resource. And if you have a family member within the same company or within the other side, you also have to declare that. So sometimes they block you altogether. So what happened in the organization I work for, there was one time where about this whole romantic relationship between husband and wife, it came to a point where you can't even marry somebody within the same organization.
Correct.
I heard that in the same organization, not just department but the organization.
Exactly, that was huge.
Wow.
So organization, a lot of people. So that was very psychologically tormenting for a lot of people, man.
Against the industrial norm.
Did this rule last? Or how long did it last?
Yeah, very good question. So it didn't last very long. I think it was 6 years. Yeah, right, so
I'm assuming it didn't last very long, as long as the same length as the VP, I guess. Same long as the one who introduces that policy.
I see what you did there. Okay, not bad. Yeah, but they still have this rule where you're not husband and wife, not allowed to work in the same department. Definitely not as subordinate and boss. So they block the means towards that.
Yeah,
that makes sense. But you see, at the end of the day, right, like, you still have to ask yourself, like, between you, every one of us has our own inherent biases. So even when it comes to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, like, he also had this, between his wives, he would have a preference one over the other. So he was asked once, who do you love most? And he said without hesitation, said Aisha. So, like, he himself had a preference. But at the same time, Allah instructed all of the men to be just to your wives. But when it comes to the matter of feelings, this is something that's out of your control. So this is something that the Prophet ﷺ taught us. So there's a dua that's narrated by Imam Ahmad. Says, oh Allah, this division of my heart is what I own. How I divide my nights and how I spend my resources with my family members, that's what I can own. But don't blame me. So, oh Allah, don't blame me for what I don't own. So that feelings in my heart, which I cannot control. And so, for example, if you have more than one child, naturally, as a father, you will favor one for whatever reason. Maybe more good looking, maybe more serves you better. Fine. That's completely natural. But you cannot allow that love to cloud your judgment and to give extra to that person. So this is an example by Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu. So his father actually gave him a special gift. So Nu'man was a special, like, somebody who has this special favor from his dad. So his dad gave him a special gift. And so he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, am I allowed to do this? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam basically told him, have fear of Allah in how you deal with your children. So even when it comes to gift, this is not even about like major things like contracts or multi-million dollar decisions. It's just gift. Allahu a'lam what it is. Tapi when it comes to small things like this also, he was told to fear Allah. Yeah. So this is something is very, very important. Like that kind of perceived conflict of interest, it's beyond our control. But it's what you do with it. That's what counts.
MashaAllah.
Very good. Okay. So, last but not least, so let's wrap things up right now. So any last words from, let's go around on this topic of conflict of interest.
Okay, so what I think is our topic of this conflict of interest has been a rather specific one, or should I say, if I can use the term, narrowed down, narrowed down to, to workplace, mostly workplace situations. But what I'd like to point out is that in the Sharia, it has always been should be a part of every believer to have this awareness about conflict of interest in any part of their lives. So, for instance, we have the concept of Amr bil Ma'ruf wa Nahi anil Munkar. So this is, in a way, it resonates with the concept of conflict of interest or how to deal with conflict of interest, because the term of in the Arabic term ta'arud bayn al mafsada wal maslaha, the conflict between maslaha and mafsada, for example. So the scholars, they say that if there is a maslaha and a mafsada, which one should you choose first? Which one should you give prevalence to?
So maslaha, right? meaning benefit.
Okay. So mafsada is basically, to translate it, it basically means something that, anything that has evil characteristics. So regardless of what that evil is, whether it's big or whether it's small, so anything that has that, it's mafsada. And maslaha is the other way around. Anything that has even a small atom of goodness, then it's maslaha. So the scholars,
they say that when these two things appear in front of you, you should always choose to push away the mafsada first. That is always number one. Rather than to you take the maslaha, and the mafsada is still there with you.
Okay, so the priority is to remove the evil first before you add the good things.
Sahih.
MashaAllah.
Okay.
So you give priority to that. So in the light of this, what I can say is this is something that has been always been a part of the Islamic tradition, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a lot of places in the Quran. One of them is that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدَعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوُنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those who call out to goodness and those who enjoins good and forbids evil, those are the ones who are successful, who are truly successful. So Allah attributes success to those who are aware of these things, who are aware of the mafsada and the maslaha, the good and the evil. Yeah, and so Allah attributes this success to this group of people.
Right.
So
that's a very good point. So the success is actually tied to the action, not the outcome necessarily.
No, it is tied to the action.
That's really nice. That's nice.
So even if we try our best with these concepts in mind, even if we try our best, of course we try our best in accordance according to what we can do, right? Because of the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said, "Man ra'a minkum munkara falyughayyirhu biyadihi fa illam yastati' fa bi lisanihi fa illam yastati' fa bi qalbihi wa dhalika adha'ful iman." So whoever one of you sees or saw a munkar or an evil, so he should change it with his hand. If he doesn't have the ability to do so, then let him change with his tongue. And if he doesn't have the ability to do so, then let him change that with his heart. And that is the weakest of all of faith. That is the weak. That is the weakest of all faith. So, what I'm trying to get here is that if we find ourselves in front of situations like this, conflict of interest, if we can't change it with our hands simply because we don't have the ability to do so, we are not the leaders who are in charge of something, or even we are not outspoken, we are afraid. Sometimes we have that weight that pulls us down until we can't even say truth, right? The truth.
Right.
So at least have that that
you hate it in your heart.
You hate it in your heart. The kurh, the ikrah in your heart. So you hate it in your heart. That is the least you can do. If you don't have that, khalas, be scared that you might not have iman in your heart.
To recognize the harm. That's the priority.
To recognize the harm. Yes.
Very good. Very good.
Inshallah.
Yeah. Actually, one of the things that did cross my mind as well, like when you mentioned this, actually to have a career to be paid for doing da'wah and teaching Islam, that's actually quite a challenging situation. So it's not necessarily something that's, of course, it's acceptable to accept money to teach. But, and of course, you need a livelihood to sustain yourself. Of course, we need to ensure that our teachers and our imams are well compensated in a way that they can continue their lives and continue their da'wah. And of course, but the thing is, they also, some of them, it can turn into a career.
Yeah.
And because, because when it comes to delivering the message of Islam and teaching people the knowledge, the deen of Allah, is tied to your livelihood, you can come to some very challenging dilemmas, So for example, you have to really ask yourself, am I doing this because I want to earn more money? Or am I genuinely doing them because I want to teach people the deen of Allah? Because I want knowledge that benefits me after I die. You have to ask yourself, do you compromise the quality of your teachings because you want to give as many classes as possible? Because I remember one of my parents told me that they used to have one ustaz who was very good in tafsir. So he wasn't very well known. Very detailed, very the way he delivered had a very strong, very, very good lah. But when he started to get a lot of students, he started to compromise in his quality, and he clearly comes unprepared. but because he has so many classes that he gives out, so it kind of macam it kind of diluted his quality in his delivery. So you have to really ask yourself, like, am I doing this because I want more and more classes, or am I doing this because it's something that I want to spread as much as possible? And I mean, you have to really ask yourself, like, if you don't get paid for a class, will you still do it when you know that you can add value? This is a very tough call. This is a very tough call. Like, so even when it comes to like having your own YouTube channel, for example, when you start like delivering message, are you paying for like when you market yourself, you pay for advertisements, you push for subscribers, are you, and you getting other people to share the content, are you doing it for your own personal gratification or because you want the message to be spread out more? Oh, it's very challenging. Very challenging. Because it can be both. It's very tough.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's very tough. Yeah. Maybe, in fact, you know,
at first you don't have the intention to get all the money from YouTube, but once you get the subscribers, khalas.
Yeah, very good point.
Yeah.
Yeah. Same. First you think like no. But once the money cut starts coming in, it's like
that is why I remember the saying of one of the pious predecessors, the Salaf. He said, I do not find anything that is more difficult than to tame your intention.
Ikhlas,
yeah. Because I find myself reading a hadith in one hadith. I find that I might read it with sincerity at the start of the hadith, but I might find myself in the middle of hadith, my intention has changed.
Subhanallah.
My intention has changed.
In one hadith. Hard.
Yeah, in one hadith.
Subhanallah.
If the Salaf say has this to say about the intentions, what about us? What are we doing? What are we doing to actually, you know, to always renew our intention? Are we doing it right? That's the question for all of us.
Very good.
I guess the filter that taking from that, the filter that we can apply to ourselves is that firstly we have to ask Allah for the righteousness of our path. It means the intention to keep us steadfast on the right intention. So one of the du'as that we can regularly recite, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, Thabbit Qulubana ala Deenik. Allah, keep us, O Turner of the Hearts, keep my heart on the straight path. So that's like firstly what we can do to keep us on the right intention. But also just consciously thinking, applying the filter that we talked about before, that we should always have taqwa of Allah. That one day you will stand in front of Allah with your deeds. And basically everything will be questioned. So nothing will be left out. So that also helps us to rectify the intention from our consciousness. So I guess these two things we can apply in our lives. Inshallah, it will lead us to the right path.
Yeah.
Very good, very good.
Also, before this assignment this week, so all my inputs of conflict of interest comes from only my professional point of view from the courses. But once we got this assignment this week, and reading some of the fatwas from our scholars, as well, not even some are recent one and some before this. You can see that the vast of mass, even though they don't call it conflict of interest, but they have addressed this issue. The essence has been addressed even before it became fashionable. Because right now it's fashionable, but this the gist was there. Right. The scholars have discussed this before. So that shows that, like, when you talk about conflict of interest, really, as a Muslim, it's part of your DNA. Because they're really, really strict, really careful when it matters, when talking about all these format components of conflict of interest. All the scholars, whether it's current, whether it's a current or prior to this, and they were discussing this 300 years, 400 years back. Nobody cares what conflict of interest is. So this is to show that conflict of interest is something that is addressed in our religion. The scholars has preceded the current generation in discussing things like this, and I think being a Muslim, we should really hold this as part of one of our DNA. We should be really proud of this. We should be the one who's promoting, propagating this, instead of people from outside telling, oh, you know, you should do this and that. No, but they themselves, from the cases, they are themselves are the one not following their own examples.
Very good point. Yeah, that means, yeah, this shows the comprehensiveness of the deed of the religion. Even though the term itself was not used explicitly, but all these issues were proactively already in the principles of our deen. And actually, the point that Reza highlighted is actually very important, like this accountability, the taqwa of Allah. This is something that our religion has so powerful that other religions don't have. So when you talk about integrity, right, we ask people, like, what's the average definition of integrity? They say it's what you do when nobody's watching. Okay, what does that mean? Like, if nobody's watching and I still do it, what does that mean? Like, I don't get caught, okay? But as a Muslim, if you know that you're accountable in the sight of Allah, this is something that should genuinely send fear in your hearts. Because even when it comes to the companions who were already promised paradise, they still fear that day of judgment. Like even Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said that if I put one foot in Jannah, in paradise, and I haven't put the other foot, I would still not feel safe from the punishment of Allah. This was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, somebody who's promised paradise. So, for somebody to have fear of the day of judgment, that is a sign of iman. And for us to have that true accountability, that's what will drive true integrity, because we know everything will be answered for on the day of judgment. So that's the most important thing. And at the end of the day, we really have to assess ourselves. Like, if we are in a position of compromise, there are always solutions. You can do it. Like, you can declare, you can delegate. This is the most important thing. Like all companies will allow that to happen. If you are in a situation where you may compromise, just give the decision making to somebody else who can do so without that bias.
MashaAllah, yeah.
It's true.
Okay,
Sorry, just to add the point where about the companion who did not feel secure unless both his feet are in Jannah, right?
Yeah,
I know. There's another story with regards to the Khalifa Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. When he went to the grave and he was crying until his beard got wet from the tears that he shed. So someone asked him, "Ya Uthman, why did you cry? Why did you cry here in this at the graveyard in the graveyard? While you can be crying over thinking about Jannah and Nar, for instance." He said, "I'm crying because." The grave, the barzakh, is our first step towards the akhirah. So when everything is good in the barzakh, everything will be made easier after that. And if everything is hard for you in the barzakh, then everything will be made even harder after that. Meaning to say, with each step, when they will be resurrected after in the day of judgment, on the day of judgment, it will only get harder for you. This is the taqwa that is present in the hearts of the companions, and of course of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said "Uzkur hadhimul ladhat al maut," he said, and this is the one of the sayings that I think resonates in all of the companions. You know, think often. Akthiru fi dhikri hadhimul ladhat al maut. The Prophet ﷺ said, increase the remembrance of the things that will demolish all pleasures, death. So this I think is a good way for us to attain that piety. You know, because everyone will die. And by thinking about death, we should actually, you know, increase our ihsan in the things that we do, right?
Inshallah.
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. Barakallahu fikum. Okay.
Barakallahu.
Okay, Aziz. Anything, Aziz Firdaus? Any last closing remarks from you?
Yeah, just for this topic of interest, I think I've experienced once that I think I remember I called Akhi Faisal. I asked about, hey Akhi, there was my first time being client. So I asked Akhi Faisal, Akhi, I just received some amount of voucher, shopping voucher. And what Akhi Faisal told me that, why don't you ask Amir? But I never asked Amir yet because I did my research first. Then I come across the hadith that you just mentioned just now.
Oh, remember? Okay.
Yeah. Why didn't he stay at his father's and mother's house to see whether he given a gift or not?
Oh, mashallah.
So then I just go to the contractor. I told him that he was a non-Muslim. So just give him... I'm sorry, I told him I just can't receive this gift. So he told me why. Because this is forbidden for my religious forbidden me to take this kind of gift.
Mashallah.
Why? And I just explained him with this hadith, and then so told me, oh, I never know that. Because my supervisor and I think they receive it as well, but
oh, subhanAllah.
Yeah, I think because maybe they don't know the ruling.
Mm.
So and then the next year, the contractor never gave any gift anymore. Yeah, alhamdulillah.
After that, wow, mashallah.
Yeah. Allah,
but until now, even though I have changed my company, we're still in contact. Because I learned a lot from him about project management.
Mm.
We still okay. can have Inshallah. This good relationship even though we have this
yeah, that's good.
Ruling.
Inshallah.
Yeah. Yeah. Alhamdulillah. Yeah, if you want to ask Amin now, you have the chance to do so. But but yeah, that's a very good point. Actually, sometimes when you stand your ground and you show that the integrity you have, that you mean business, that there's some things that you just can't compromise. It's not that I don't like you. Actually, people have a lot more respect for that, even if they're the ones who are offering that. Say, like, oh, this is somebody who I can trust.
Right. Yeah.
And sometimes people don't see it that way. Sometimes people think that when you refuse, like it's something that jeopardizes your relationship. But in the long run, like you said, like it's in everyone's best interest now.
I think even better.
Even better, yeah. MashaAllah. Yeah.
Right, right. You are doing something to actually change the status quo, you know? So, not a lot of people, I would think, are doing that. So, yeah, that's MashaAllah. Something that the Muslim should be first and foremost in forbidding the evil and joining the good, like Shami said before.
MashaAllah.
I just want to share...
Yeah, yes, tafadhal.
Little things in our company. The one that always happen is regarding claims. You know, again.
Right.
this one is very sensitive one.
Is it claim to fame or travel claims?
Travel claims. this one people always do because they're trapped in between, right? Because other colleagues claim 50 kilometer to the client office, to the contractor office, right?
Okay.
But when you Google Map, it is only 30 km, right?
Okay.
How do you do that? If you want to claim 30 km, the claim will conflict to others, right? Our boss even claim 50 km, right?
Mm.
So how do you do that? And then sometimes you carpool with your friend from base to the HQ, right? So carpool, but the receipt is separate, something like that.
Sure.
And also extra days of traveling claim, it's not even the business day, right? And then you use debit card, credit card points to buy plane tickets and also rent a car and hotels, right?
Ah, wow, yeah.
So the small things like this always we already get used to it, but we need to think about it lah.
Yes, yes.
And also it is a conflict between our colleague as well, right? So from my personal view, I tend not to claim it at all. just to avoid this conflict.
Wow,
may Allah increase your rezeki.
Wow, I mean.
Wow, mashallah.
That's all from me.
Okay, that's a, yeah, there are two really good points there. So first of all, like you're saying, like when you do the right thing, it's going against the wave. That's already, that's a common challenge that we have. But I think there's another one as well, like for you to, so you use the company, you do it for company purchasing, but you get the points for your own personal benefit. So when you purchase tickets on your offline and you get points, for example, or you use cards, you get, yeah. Are you allowed to do this or not? Like, is this something that the scholars have spoken about for you to get these side benefits? Does anybody want to answer?
Yeah, I saw one of from Islam QA. She Salim okay. Munajid. Yeah, see, it's right. it's not permissible for this.
It's not permissible. Wow.
It's not permissible for you. So what he tried to give some suggestion like with that reading points, what you can do. You can either go clean back to your. Meaning you can either talk to your supervisor, to your boss, yeah, okay, these are the amount of points I have, yeah. Can I take it or do you want it? So if you want it, then I'll get the equivalent value to it and I'll pass it to you, something like that, yeah. May I deduct from the claims or whatsoever, yeah. That's one.
That's a very strong heart.
Yeah, but
the question also get really complicated. For instance, like say that if I have an overseas flight that requires currency exchange, so the if I exchange, I get some additional money. Is that money haram or halal for me to take? You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, I mean, okay. Right.
They also have this kind of question. Yeah.
Mm.
Right. Just one thing to share. Taking into account all of those things, it might be something that can be tough to do for some because it goes against our natural desire for to make it easy on us, for example, or to get favors from something. But just remember this hadith from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Abu Qatadah reported that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Verily, you will never leave anything for the sake of Allah, but that Allah will replace it with something better." So when you face these situations, keep that in mind that you maintain the taqwa of Allah and keep the rights of Allah, even though you feel like you're losing something at something small at that time, but remember that Allah will always replace it with something better. So that's something
beautiful. Okay. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Thank you and Jazakumullahu Khairan for spending time with us in this episode of the Barakah Effect podcast. We hope you've gained some benefit from the discussion and learned something that can help you take small steps to improve your life and those around you. If you did learn something valuable, don't forget to love for others what you love for yourself and share about this episode of the Barakah Effect podcast to your loved ones who you know can benefit from these discussions so that you can also earn your share of the reward in the Akhirah. Inshallah. In the spirit of continuous improvement, please do get in touch with the team over at our social media pages at Facebook and Instagram if you have any comments, feedbacks, and suggestions on how we can improve further. Please don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel of the Barakah Effect podcast over at YouTube and the other podcast platforms, as this will greatly help spread our message so that we can reach out to more awesome, like-minded individuals such as yourself. Until next time, Barakallahu fikum.